Morning. You guys doing all right? Oh, man. Good to see everybody here today. This is the... Did anybody know? Easter was last week, and Easter was ridiculously awesome. It was our greatest Easter numerically, but I got to baptize London, my daughter, last week, so that took it to a stratosphere, you know? It was spectacular, but the numbers from last week when we got them and we shared them, and most of you guys saw them on social media, but we broke every stat we've ever had. It was the biggest Easter yet. We broke 600 people for the first time ever on a Sunday, and so this God's doing something awesome, and it's great. And so last week you might have noticed we had our video crew around. And they were capturing all the elements from last week, and they got us the video in time to show it today. And so, if you missed last week, pay attention to this. But if you were here, I want you to pay attention to this too. Also, it was awesome, and I haven't cried. I mean, I haven't not cried every time I've watched it. And so, it's just really. Turn your attention to the screen. Check this out.
It's springtime now. The birds are chirping in the morning. There's new light. It's springtime now. The birds are chirping in the morning. There's new life coming up from the ground. It's a beautiful time of year. It's an exciting time of year for you weird people that eat peeps, those little yellow squishy things. You know that's not real food, right? You know that's just, it's chemicals with eyes. But anyway.
Carry that kind of weight. It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried. My tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called.
I have a few.
Yeah. How awesome is that, right? Just to celebrate what God's doing in people's lives is just amazing. It's just so awesome. And thank you, everybody, who made last week happen.
It's so all the birds are chirping.
It is. Birds are chirping. Thanks. Thanks, PC. But a big thanks to everybody who made last week happen. The church, you know, universal, global, is not a business. And even though it has some business-like aspects to it, it's not a business. It's a nonprofit organization as far as the government's concerned, but that's not exactly what Jesus had in mind. The church is a family. We are all brothers and sisters, right? Christ, he's actually our adopted brother, but he's the head of the church. He fills these two roles, and that's what that's all about. That's what Easter is all about, what we just saw. That's what this is all about. It's family. It's coming together. It's pulling together and celebrating. When somebody has a win in their life, we all celebrate together. When somebody's hurting, we all hurt with them. The church is a family. That's the beauty of what this is. It's not an kind of entertainment. This is not a show of some sort, although I'm standing on a stage and there's lights and this is a comedy club other times of the day, other times of the week. It's not a show. This is family. This is a time where we come and celebrate together what God's doing with us. And it's a perfect segue right into our new series called Welcome Home. And this series is all designed around the idea that we, the family of God, are a family. God's sons and daughters, we are a family. And there is a big invitation to come back home, to welcome home, to join the family. And so if this is your first time with us today, this invitation is perfect for you. This whole series is going to be perfect for you. Maybe you've been coming for a while and you're still kind of kicking the tires on faith and trying to see if this stuff is really for you, if this is really what you're all about. This series is going to be perfect for you. If you're out there watching in TV land or on the internet, this series is a perfect invitation to faith in Christ and to God's people as well. And so I'm super pumped to jump into this series with you. This series is actually going to be focusing on the Ten Commandments, which at first glance are the least welcome home-like scriptures out of the whole Bible, because it sounds like a big list of do's and don'ts, right? That's the way that I have normally seen them, and I've usually read them as a list of, hey, don't do this, don't do that. If you're going to be a good Christian boy or girl, you need to listen to these rules, do this, don't do that. But that's not really how they are designed. That's not really what they are meant to be. A few little known facts. Not all the churches read the same Ten Commandments the same way. If you were to go to different faiths or churches, they would not all have the same 10 listed in the same way. They reorder them some ways. According to Mel Brooks, there was originally 15 of them, but Moses couldn't hold three tablets, so he dropped one. And so we only had 10 left. But the Ten Commandments are not a list of do's and don'ts. They are an invitation to welcome home. And because of that, I believe this is the single most misunderstood set of scriptures in the entire Bible. I believe this list of Ten Commandments found in two places, Exodus 20, Deuteronomy 5, are the single most misunderstood set of scriptures in the entire Bible. And for that reason and that reason alone, we're going to spend some time in them and discover that they are actually an invitation to a deeper relationship with God and each other. It's a beautiful invitation. It's a mirror of what Jesus was coming to do on the Sermon on the Mount. It shows us the heart of the Father, and Jesus did the exact same thing when he came and walked the earth. It's an invitation to a deeper relationship. It's not rules or qualifications that if you do them, then you'll be in. That's how most of us read them. That's how I always used to read them. It's if you do these things, then you're in. No, in fact, they are family rules for those that are already in. So check this out. I don't give rules to the neighbor's kids. Like when little Jimmy comes over, I don't say, hey, did you brush your teeth this morning? Did you do your homework? You know, it's bath time, buddy. You better get in there. You know, little Jimmy is somebody else's problem. He's not my problem at all. Are giving rules to their own children, right? Hey, you better brush your teeth before you leave the house, because them teeth are wicked. You know, like you need to go take care of them. Like a good parent takes care of their child and sets rules. Like, hey, when you get home from school, you need to do your homework. I didn't understand when I was in school, and you're not going to understand now either. But when you're a parent, you can enforce this rule in your kids. This misery you can extend to you're the next generation. Hey, it's bath time. Like, I, as a good parent, I want to take care of my child and instill some rules. If she doesn't do them, it doesn't mean she's out of the family, right? Not at all. It means she's still in the family. These are rules that actually govern what it means to be a part of the family. The Ten Commandments that God gave us in these two places are actually lists of rules for people that are already in the family of God. The Ten Commandments are an invitation into a relationship with God and God's people. These are given because they are all we are already in the family of God. So this is what these Ten Commandments are really all about. The Ten Commandments, they're found in two places, as I mentioned, Exodus 20, Deuteronomy 5. Deuteronomy is a copy of them. It's kind of a rewritten version. Exodus is the historical side of it, and so we need to know where this stands in the scheme of things. Abraham, generations before, was promised a certain land. God said, hey, this is going to be your land, from this place to this to that. That is going to be yours, but you're not going to see it in your time, in your generation. It's going to be 430 years from now before your descendants actually take it. And so Abraham's great-grandson, Joseph, after there was a famine in the land, he went to Egypt and he was welcomed there. It's a great story late in Genesis. But there was a time when his family came to meet him in Egypt, and he provided for them shelter, protection, provision. They showed up as outsiders. He gave them identity. He said, no, they're a part of my family. They can be welcomed into this place. It's a beautiful picture of what God does for us also as he welcomes us in. He gives us protection and provision, pulls us into his family. Well, generations later, new pharaohs weren't so friendly with Joseph and his family because Joseph's family, his father was named Israel. Now they're numbered into the millions. And so that pharaoh said, no, this is not going to work out. I'm going to enforce slavery upon you. And so he made them his workforce. And so 430 years after this prophecy, they find themselves in Egypt, and it's not a very pretty picture. God selects Moses as a liberator, a type of Christ, sends him back into Egypt. We know the plagues that are so famous. The plagues come down. God parts the Red Sea, and they find themselves on their way out of Egypt. It's a beautiful thing. God liberates them. High fives on the other side of the shore. Everything is awesome. You know, life is great. Well, now they're in the desert, and they're thinking, this may not have been a great idea. Like, now we don't have anything. You know, at least back there, we had three meals a day. And, you know, the guards told us when we can go use the bathroom. I had a comfy bed. It might have been prison, but it's better than being out here and having nothing at all. They were born into slavery generation upon generation, so they didn't know what it meant to be free. So God needed to intervene. 40 days after they leave Egypt, they come to this Mount Sinai, and God has this interaction, this moment with them 40 days after they leave Egypt. And he comes down to meet them. Now, I want us to put it into a different set of terms. If Mount Sinai was a proposal, or if the parting the Red Sea was a proposal of sorts, God getting down on one knee and says, you know, will you come with me? Will you be my bride? And they say yes, and he says, all right, let's go. 40 days later, they end up at the chapel, and this is wedding day. Mount Sinai is actually the wedding day, and these are the exchange of vows. This is what the environment is, and this is how the Jewish people look at this moment. It's the day when God vowed himself, covenanted himself to his people, and his people covenanted themselves back to God. This is what's actually happening. It's really a relationship. And so we know what the Ten Commandments are. Most of us can say them. Here's an oversimplified version of the list of them. Number one, have no other gods before me. Number two, no graven images or idols. Number three, don't take the Lord's name in vain. Four, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Number five, honor your father and mother. This is the only commandment that has a promise with it of the ten. It's a beautiful thing. Can't wait to get into that. Number six, don't murder. Number seven, don't commit adultery. Eight, don't steal. Number nine, don't lie. 10, don't covet your neighbor's stuff, including their family. Like, you need to be grateful for what you have. Now, there are so many different views of this, and the Jews have been talking about this and debating it for generations, and it's a beautiful thing. But I want to talk about just two quick divisions of the 10. The first four deal with our relationship with God. It's a vertical scenario. The second six are our relationship on a horizontal scenario. And I look at them in the context of marriage vows. God says the first thing, hey, you need to forsake all others. This is a monogamous relationship. I'm not going to cheat on you. You don't cheat on me. It's the first vow that God says. We need to have each other's back in this. The second one, he says, don't fall in love with the idea of me or my image. Just like in a marriage relationship, time will come when this, you know, body of chiseled, you know, marble will eventually fade, you know? And so I needed Lori to not fall in love with the 20-year-old version of myself or the 35-year-old version of myself, because eventually this is all going to fall. It's going to be bad, you know, and I'm already on the way. So he says, look, don't fall in love with the idea of me or the image of me. You need to fall in love with the me that's beneath the surface. Can you see the correlation? It's like a wedding vow. Look, it's not. Don't fall in love with the idea of me, the image of me. You need to fall in love with the me, the real me, deep down inside. The third one, he says, don't take my name and not mean it. That's deep. As a bride coming to take the name of her husband, don't take my name on and then go walk out on the earth and through the world and trash my name. Don't take my name if you don't really mean it. Don't use my name in vain. It's not just doesn't mean verbally saying God's name in vain. It's like, are you going to take his name on as a Christian, as a believer, and then go out and tarnish his name? That's not a good thing. So he says, don't take my name if you don't mean it. And lastly, he says, you need to make room for me. Honor the Sabbath. This is the date night. We need to have date night. We need to commit to it. It was God's idea. Date night. It's God's idea. It just happened to be a whole day, you know? Which is cool with me. God, you want to take me out on an awesome date? This is great. I can carve out some time. I'll honor the Sabbath. I'll remember it. I'll keep it on my schedule. Nothing is going to come in the way of our time together. And so this is the first four. These are wedding vows, marriage vows between God's people and him. This is what we're covenanting together. I'm not going to cheat on you. You don't cheat on me. I'm not going to fall in love with the image or the idea of you. I want to fall in love with the real you deep down beneath the surface. If you're going to take my name, let's do this thing together. Don't walk away from it. Are we going to do this? Are you going to carve out time for me? It's a beautiful picture of an invitation to a deeper relationship with God. Number five is actually the bridge between the vertical relationship and the horizontal one. This is where we honor our parents. He says, you need to honor the authority that I've put over you. Pretend like they are me. Pretend like your parents are me, that they are the authority that's directly over you. Honor them like you would honor me. And then he finishes the last five. Don't kill each other while I'm at the grocery store. You know, this is for his kids. Like, I'm going to step out of the room for a couple of minutes. Don't kill each other. Literally. Don't murder. You should be monogamous with each other, too. Don't commit adultery. Don't take anything without paying for it. Say what you mean what you say. Don't want what you don't have. You should be grateful for the things that you have. These are all invitations to a deeper relationship with God and a deeper relationship with each other. First thing I want to throw out here is this. If these are invitations to a deeper relationship, you determine the depth of your relationships with God and with others. This is not a passive scenario. You and I are the ones who determine the depths of our relationship with God and with others. Exodus chapter 20, before we get into the all 10 of them, I want us to look at what happens after this. In verse 18, Exodus chapter 20, when the people saw the thunder and the lightning, heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. Now, let's back up for a second. Remember, this is like a wedding that's happening. This is a wedding ceremony. Did anybody's weddings have a lot of crazy stuff going on? Garland and lanterns and flower petals. Anybody have, you know, bands playing, unity candles? Anybody have the crazy stuff going? Lori is a self-proclaimed bridezilla. She will tell you this. I'm not throwing her under the bus. We had too many people at our wedding. It was, and there was stuff everywhere. There was things all over the place. There was flower petals the right way. She trained her bridesmaids to come down and turn a certain way so their train would, like, wrap around them. It was nuts. As a good, you know, bridegroom, I just stayed out of the way. Asked, what do you need me to pick up? What do you need me to take over here or there? I'll show up. I'll be there the day of, you know? If you think your wedding was bad, or if you have seen a wedding that was bad, I want you to pay attention to God's wedding ceremony. There's thunder and lightning. There's fire that's consuming the mountain. There's a cloud, a thick, dark cloud. When God speaks, it's this loud, like all they could call it was a trumpet sound. It was craziness. I mean, it was elaborate. This show of his spirit was crazy. It was nuts. And it says in Exodus 20, verse 18, when they saw all these things, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance. Verse 19, they said to Moses, hey, why don't you speak to us yourself and we'll listen, but don't have God speak to us or we're going to die. It's not going to end well for us. Verse 20, Moses said to the people, don't be afraid. God's come to test you or to prove you. This is a relationship thing. Are you really going to do this? So that the fear of God will be with you and keep you from sinning. Sinning is breaking the covenant. Is it going to stay with you? Are you going to walk away with a deep relationship, or are you going to break this covenant later? Verse 21, the people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. The invitation comes with the decision. You determine the depth of your relationship with God. Are you going to step into the darkness? Are you going to step into the unknown? Or are you going to stay back on the edge where it's safe and just look at it from a distance? This mirrors the 21st century church, really. God, you speak to PC, you give him the download, we'll show up on Sunday and hear what you had to say. Now, that's not a bad thing. I mean, this is the way that it's designed. But if this is the only interaction we have with God, coming to listening to a guy talking to a microphone from the stage, then we're missing the real relationship. If all I get from Lori is someone else's play-by-play of what she's done through her day, hey, how was Lori today? She do all right? Yeah, she got to work. She did a couple things on a computer. It was great. She went to lunch. It was awesome. She went home. She got some rest. Things were great. It's fantastic. Man, awesome. I'm so glad she's my wife. Next. Next time, can we do this again? Can you tell me how she's doing? If that's all our relationship with it is it a real relationship? I mean, there's so much depth that we're missing. We could be married, and that's all we're getting is the play-by-play. Maybe I'm just following her on social media and seeing how her life is going without actually involving myself into her life, into her day-by-day or relationship with her. So God's saying, look, I want an intimate relationship with every single one of you individually. And the people of Israel, they said, nah, I don't think it's going to work out. So Moses, you go and talk and then come and just tell us what he said. God said, okay, that's how we'll start. But I'll continue to pursue an individual relationship with every single one of you. I will woo you into a relationship with me. So the first thing we need to know is we determine the level of our relationship with God. So today I want to talk about the first commandment. That's just an intro to the series. Today I want to dive into the first commandment together and talk about the first principle. Now, what we need to know is beneath these commandments are principles of living. And these principles are the invitation to draw ourselves into a deeper relationship with God and ourselves. So today I want to talk about the principle of priority. The principle of priority as we look at the very first commandment. So if you don't have your Bible open, grab it, turn with me. Exodus chapter 20 is where we're going to be. Exodus 20, the first and second verses and third verse is all we're going to get to today as we look at the first commandment. Exodus 20, starting at the very first verse. And God spoke all of these words. Verse 2, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Now, let's pause there for just 1 second. He starts with this phrase, I am. Now, we've heard this phrase before. It's the unpronounceable name of God. It's what he said at the burning bush when Moses says, hey, they're going to ask me who told me to do this. Who should I tell them sent me? And he said, I am. We've put some vowels in there so we can say it as Jehovah. The YHVH is really just the consonants of it. It means the eternal one, the God who always was, always is, and always will be. That's the God who is. He says, so I am the Lord your God. Now, these are two awesome words also. Your God, he implies relationship. He implies possession. I'm yours. You're mine. Let's do this thing. This is awesome. We're already started the relationship. I proposed. You said yes. Now I'm your God. Let's make this thing official. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Now, let's kind of parallel this in our current time. I want you to imagine with me a guy who rescues his fiance or the love of his life from a terribly abusive home. verbally, physically abusive, sexually abusive. This home is toxic in every single way. And this guy comes in and takes the love of his life and rescues her from this toxic environment. Takes her out of that environment and says, look, let's start a new relationship or a new life together. Me and you, let's do this thing together. Let's leave the chaos and the toxicity of yesterday behind, the brokenness behind, the slavery that you were in behind, the bondage that you were in. Let's leave it behind and start a new relationship together today. Let's do this together. God reminds them, I was the one who brought you out of that stuff. Now, whenever somebody tells me, hey, Chris, I was the one who did this thing for you, I immediately expect some type of repayment to follow that, right? I was the one who did this favor for you. I was the one who cleaned up your mess here. I'm thinking, well, what do I owe you? If you did that for me, apparently I'm indebted to you in some way. But when God says it, there's no indebtedness because his love is always unconditional. I was the one who brought you out of Egypt, out of slavery, out of that abuse, out of that mess. And the reason I did it is because I wanted to bring you to myself. All I want you to do is answer back with a loving relationship. You don't owe me that. It's your decision. It's your choice. But I took you out of that mess so I could bring you to myself. I was the one who did that. You don't owe me. My love is unconditional. But I brought you to me so we could do this together. I am the Lord, your God. I was the one who rescued you. Will you do this together with me? I brought you to myself. Verse 3, and this is the first commandment we have. It says, you shall have no other gods before me. Now, most of our Bibles have some type of asterisk or letter or something right after that word before, because it sounds like God is saying, you shall have no other gods before me. You can have them in other places, just not here in front of me. That's one way we can read that, but that's certainly not what God was saying. The word before can be taken as many different ways: before, besides, in front, behind, over there, no gods, period, anywhere. This is not going to work out. It's a conjunction, not a prepositional phrase. A prepositional phrase means it's clarifying the rest of the sentence. You shall have no other gods in this particular place before me. But it's not at all. It's a conjunction. The first part of the sentence can stand by itself. You shall have no other gods. It could be a period right there, period, done. End of sentence. He clarified, before me, next to me, beside me, behind me, anywhere else. Like, this isn't going to work out. You have to compare it to the rest of the scripture. Isaiah 45:5 says it another way. I am the Lord, and there is no other. What that means in the Hebrew is no other. It's zero. Apart from me, there is no God. That's pretty clear, right? God is saying, look, it's a monogamous relationship. It's me and you together. Are you cool with us being in this together? No one else is involved. We're not swinging. We're not, there's no friends coming over. This is it. It's us. Me and you, eye to eye, we are in this relationship together. Are we doing this? Are we? There's nobody else before and besides me. There's no side piece, as the kids call it. Are we doing this together or not? If we're in a relationship, these are the ground rules. No other gods before. Will you forsake all the others as long as we both shall live? I do. This is the first commandment. This is the first vow. It's a covenant together. There is no other God besides God. And so the principle of priority is this. When we put God first in every area, God takes care of us in every way. When we put God first in every area of our life, he takes care of us in every way. Those who put God first, who make him their priority, who make the relationship with God singular, there is no extra, there is no anything else being added to it. It's me and you. He takes responsibility for that life. He comes along and says, okay, we are doing this together. You're mine. I am yours. I'm taking responsibility for you. I will take care of all your needs according to my riches and glory. I will take care of your life. That's a beautiful promise that we have. When I was growing up, I wasn't concerned about the BGE bill. When I was 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years old,
I'd leave the door wide open, and my dad would say, hey, we're not trying to cool the neighborhood. Shut the door. You know, okay, my bad. When I'd be standing at the refrigerator looking at every shelf over and over again, there's got to be something in here. He's like, man, we cooling the whole house. Shut the refrigerator. You know, sorry, Dad. You know, close it. 5 minutes later, I come right back. I'm peeking in again like something was going to magically appear. I'd leave the lights on in every single room, just boom, 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 because I didn't know if I was going back in the room, and I didn't want to have the labor of having to turn the light back on again, you know? My dad'd be like, hey, turn the lights off, man. I didn't understand that there needed to be power paid for by someone else. I just enjoyed the power that was given to me. I enjoyed all the luxuries that were provided for me. I wasn't concerned about it because my father took care of it. If my dad came home and he slapped the bill on the table and he says, look, I'm going to pay my portion, you pay yours, and we'll all pay this together, I would have been aware of a much greater need. The door never would have been left open. All the lights would have been off. And that's what I do in my house now. I'm walking through the house. Okay, light off, light off, light off. Make sure all these doors are closed, you know, I'm stuffing socks in windows, you know. No heat's leaving this house. I'm on it. But history repeats itself. My daughter, she doesn't know. She has no idea because her father is taking care of her needs. So it's not a concern for her. When we enter into this relationship with God, he assumes our needs as his own. He takes responsibility for our lives. The great Charles Stanley, he said it this way. He says, God takes full responsibility for the life wholly devoted to him. God assumes our needs. He assumes our life and what it needs to survive. It becomes his responsibility now. When we put God first in every area, he takes care of our needs in every way. Let me show you this verse in 2 Peter, the disciple who walked with Jesus. He said this way, 2 Peter 1:3, he says, by his divine power, that's God, he's given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know him, the one who called us to himself. How beautiful is that, right? Coming to know him, the one who called us. He rescued us out of slavery, out of bondage. He called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. It was God's greatness who drew us out and rescued us. And what did he do? He brought us to himself so that we could know him. Let's look at it in reverse. So now we have all that we need to live a godly life by his divine power. That's the answer to the first commandment right in front of us. He, by his power, he's given us everything we need. And it was all so we could know him better. He was the one who brought us out so that that could happen. He brought us out so that we could know him better. Under his umbrella, we have provision, protection, identity, goodness, and grace. When we put God first place in our life, he takes care of us in every single way. When God now is our first priority, here's the beautiful thing, it starts to trickle down to us. His priorities become our priorities. Now, this is where the rubber meets the road. We can say with our mouth, God, you have first place in my life. Well, the natural progression is if he's first, then what he wants to be first also becomes what you want to be first. See, I can have Lori as a priority in my life, but then go do all the things that I want to do. If my actions don't prove that she really is a first priority, then she's not a first priority. It's just lip service. We can say that God has first place in our hearts, but if our lives don't mirror that, then it's just lip service. He's saying, if I'm first place, then it'll begin to trickle its way down into your life, into your actions, into your calendar, into your wallet, into your purse, into your life, into your words, into your friends, into your home, into your workplace, into your car. What I love will become what you love. Do you think I really like to watch HGTV? No, the answer is no, okay? If you didn't know that, I don't. I don't like to watch it. But I will watch it because I know my wife likes to watch it. And a happy wife is a happy life. Husbands know what I'm talking about. Sorry. And so I love it because she loves it. There are times, very few times, when she'll let me watch baseball when we're all together, but she'll put up with it. God's still working on her heart. Pray for her. But the only reason she doesn't rip the TV off the wall, smash it to 1,000 bits, or turn the channel immediately is because she knows I love it. And so what's a priority to me becomes a priority to her. It's no different in our relationship with God. If he is first place in our life, it will trickle down into our actions, into our thoughts, into our friends, into our workplace, into our car, to our living space, how we interact with people. We find out that God has a priority on the poor, that God has a priority on those who are destitute and have been dealt a bad hand. God loves the fatherless. He becomes the father to the fatherless. And we find out that's his priority. Well, guess what? As a walking believer of God, as a disciple of Christ, his priorities become my priorities. So when I see someone who's dealt a bad hand in their life, I start to take a focus in them. It's not about me anymore. I know my Father loves them more than anything in the world, and so now I love them more than anything in the world. My God loves justice, and so I have my eyes looking out for injustice, and I'm going to invest what I can to bring that to a different state, a different place, because God's priorities now become my priorities. As believers, as followers of Christ, this is the progression. God, your first place. What you care about, now I care about. That's what it means when we start to read the word. We find out what he really cares about. We start to find out what he's all about, and it becomes our own priority. And so when he's first place, his priorities become our priorities. Here's how that looks in real life. Proper priorities bring alignment, and proper alignment in our life brings health. Proper priorities bring alignment. Proper alignment brings health to us. I want to read this Psalm number 1. It's a beautiful psalm. I want to read it to you this morning. I want you to see what happens when we choose his way, when we choose him to be first place in our life. What's the natural progression? So listen to how David wrote this. He says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight, whose wants, whose desires, whose priorities is in the law of the Lord, and he meditates on his law day and night." It's become a priority in this guy's heart. "That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers." Verse 4, "Not so with the wicked. They're like chaff that the wind just blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment," or they cannot stand in God's judgment. They have no leg to stand on, is what he's saying. They will not stand in the judgment, "nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous. He takes care of those who've come under his umbrella, his authority, under his family, under his name. The Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction." When we make God first place in our life, it's like we are a tree that he plants at the right place. We may not understand it at the time, but the further our roots begin to go down beneath the surface, we start to understand, oh man, there's a water source nearby. There's a source that God has planted me here for a reason. There are certain things that God wants to do in my life that I don't understand when I first hear them. But when I say, you know what? You're in charge. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to listen to what you're telling me. In time, I'll understand, you know what? I'm in the right place. God was right the entire time. I'm in the right place at the right time. When the seasons come, the fruits start to work their way out into my life, and the world can see, hey, there's something different about you. You have a different source. It's because we've made God our priority. Our number one priority. I want to be like a tree planted by streams of living water, of life. I want my fruit to bear in its season. My leaves, my life, the fruit of my life, the things that I'm trying to produce in my life, I don't want them to wither. He says everything they do begins to prosper because they've planted themselves in the right place, in the right family, under the right name. We make God first place in every area. He takes care of our needs in every way. It's the principle of priority. But like Peter said, he says, all these things have happened so that we would come to know him. Maybe this morning you've looked at these Ten Commandments, or you've looked at the God of Scripture, maybe just the God of the Old Testament. You said, man, I don't know about that guy. It looks scary. It looks crazy. I don't know if I can have a relationship with him. I just don't know if I can trust him. I understand it. I didn't know if I could do it myself. There are people in this room from the video we showed earlier getting baptized saying, I don't know if I can trust God. I don't know if I can trust him with my life. In time, we find ourselves planted and living water flowing through our veins because we said yes to the invitation to know him. That invitation is extended to everyone in this room, everyone in the sound of my voice this morning. I pray you would not let this moment pass without saying yes to him. I'm going to ask you to take a posture of prayer this morning, heads bowed, eyes closed across the room. That's you this morning. We could take care of that real easy. Scripture says all we have to do is believe in our heart, confess with our mouth. We will be saved. This is a private moment just between you and God. That's why we ask everybody to bow their heads, everybody to close their eyes. This is just between you and God. No one else around, no one looking around. But we're all going to pray in a moment together. Everyone across the room is going to. But you this morning, if you say you want to know him, if you want to say yes to the invitation to begin a relationship with him, let me tell you, it's the best decision you will ever make. If that's you this morning, on the count of three, I just want you to slip your hand in the air. Again, this is between you and God, no one looking around. One, I want you to know that he loves you unconditionally. Two, there's nothing you can do to change it. Three, just slip your hand up in the air, saying yes to him. Thank you for those hands already. Wow, one, two, three, four. Awesome. Praise God. Five, six, seven. Yeah, awesome. Hey, awesome. Awesome. You can put your hands down. Every head bowed, eyes closed. I want every voice to say this prayer with me this morning. Whether you raised your hand or you didn't, say this after me. Say, Jesus, thank you for a new beginning. I thank you for a fresh start. Come into my heart and make me new. I admit I can't do this on my own. I need you. So I confess that I'm not perfect, but in you, I am forgiven. Today, I am brand new. In Jesus' name, amen. Can we put our hands together to celebrate with those people who made a decision for Jesus today? Yes. My hand to Kate. She'll give you a couple things letting us go, and then I'm going to pray us out in just a second.
Kate. Great. So if today is your first time here, we are so glad you came, and we have a special gift for you, this nice handy-dandy mug. And I think that actually has a couple little things that are added into it at the Next Steps table. So, if today is your second time here, we have this beautiful shirt. Second time here. Yes. So, Next Steps table has a shirt for you for your second time here. Now, if you have not received one of these and you've been here maybe your 100th or 200th time, these are purchasable at the Next Steps table, so they're there. Also, if you received Jesus for the first time today or recommitted your life to Jesus and you have any questions or you just want somebody to pray with you, I'll be at the Next Steps table and you can see me there. So we also just want to thank you for your generous giving. For our regular attenders, our tithe boxes are on either side as you go out the door.
Awesome. Let me pray over you guys and let you go. God, thank you so much for your goodness. Thank you that you've invited us into a beautiful relationship with you. We say yes to that today and every day. We renew our commitment, our covenant to you. God, we know that you love us, and so we live in love to you. Thank you, God. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys. See you next week.